Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and my pleasure to welcome you to the 163rd inaugural lecture of the University of Nigeria. The Vice Chancellor, sir, my greetings. The Deputy Vice Chancellor, Academic Professor Orama, representing the Vice Chancellor. The inaugural lecturer, Professor Henrietta Okafor, the husband to the inaugural lecturer, the Dean of the College of Medicine, Dean of the Faculty of Medicine, distinguished past inaugural lecturers, deans of faculty, professors, members of the University of Nigeria Senate, distinguished academics, and administrative staff of the university. It's my pleasure to welcome you to today's inaugural lecture. May we all rise, please, for the national anthem. University of Nigeria song.
University of Nigeria, my alma mater.
Hail and rejoice for the sake of truth.
Where your men and women do seek for
for the sake of knowledge,
where the nation's potentials do brood in the nest.
Hail and rejoice for her noble ideals.
Hail varsity by excellence, her dreams come true.
Hail and rejoice for the giants awaits. My alma mater, my alma mater. And by ideas, and great art thou, in science and in arts, in all the realms of learning, thou art horse and wine.
University of Nigeria, my alma mater.
Hail and rejoice for her lofty plans.
The verses that excited the soft green fields.
Rejoice for her beauty's sake.
Hail varsity of her glory, the pride of her land.
Hail and rejoice for her light will shine.
Hail varsity by excellence, her dreams come true.
Hail and rejoice for the giants awaits. My alma mater. And great art thou, in science and in arts, in all the
are still standing, may I request Venerable Dr. Kenechukwu Ilo to please lead us in an opening prayer. Thank you.
Let us pray. Our God and our Father, we thank you for today. We bless your name for the privilege you've given us to be partakers of life. We thank you, Lord, for bringing us today, even for 163rd inaugural lecture of the University of Nigeria. We thank you for the inaugural lecturer, Professor Henrietta Okafor, for your guidance even up till now. Father, we commit this program onto your hand. We ask, Lord, that you take absolute control, that at the end, your name and your name alone will be glorified. Blessed be your holy name, for we pray in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you very much. Please may be seated. Thank you again. May I request the public relations officer of the university, Chief Okun Omeako, to do the recognitions and introductions, sir.
Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir. Our distinguished inaugural lecturer at 163rd, principal officers of this Citadel of Learning, the University of Nigeria, the inaugural lecturer and spouse here with us, distinguished members of the academic, members of the family of the inaugural lecturer, and lionesses. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, it's my pleasure to welcome us all to the moot court here at the Enugu campus of the University of Nigeria. It's a thing of joy to be back here after about a year of continued absence occasioned by the COVID pandemic, which retired all of us to our homes. And we're very happy and grateful to God for being all here. If you're here, that means you're a victor. You have won. So how about appreciating ourselves with glory to God in any way? Grateful to God for this rare opportunity. Today, we are happy to be here, although we're still observing the COVID-19 protocols, and you can see we're maintaining social distancing and restricted number of participants at this 163rd inaugural lecture, all within the confines of what the pandemic has brought to us. We're happy to be here. Only last week we were able to flag off the 162nd inaugural lecture at the Enugu campus. And today, the 163rd will be highlighting sustaining healthy kidneys from nascence, the role of watchmen. Permit me at this point in time to unveil, as chairman of today's event, the 15th Vice Chancellor of the University of Nigeria, Professor Charles Arezechukwu Igwe, the first indigenous graduate of this university to occupy that seat, and we quite acknowledge him. He is today ably represented by the Deputy Vice Chancellor Academic. Please, let's give it all up to Professor Johnson Orama. You're welcome, sir. Need I talk so much about the 163rd inaugural lecturer, our own Professor Henrietta Uchenna Okafor? Need I talk about the husband equally, who has been the pillar of support for her success story? May I present the husband first? Chief Sir Chude Okafor, husband to inaugural lecturer. You're welcome, sir. Thank you for letting us have her for today. It's not quite easy to have a piece of beauty and academic with great successes. And as epitomized today, we'll be dipping deep on the academic discourse that will be presented to us by Professor Henrietta Uchenna Okafor. At the appropriate time, we're going to listen to her citation. But permit me, Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, to formally announce that we have our 163rd inaugural lecturer here at the University of Nigeria physically present. I present to us Professor Henrietta Uchenna Okafor. You're welcome, ma'am. There's no doubt the fact that it's going to be an exciting discourse which we are going to really savour in a few minutes' time. A lady of lots of academic successes to her credit. Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, it's exciting to note that there are other past inaugural lecturers who are here to lend support. Professor Anthony Ikefuna, who is here with us, the 149th inaugural lecturer. The 153rd inaugural lecturer, Professor Emma Obikili. Professor Ifeoma Olase was the 95th inaugural lecturer. She's also here lending support. And of course, the dean, who is proudly presenting the 163rd inaugural lecturer for us today, Professor Kajetan Onyedum, Dean, Faculty of Medical Sciences. As we witnessed the procession, there were other readers, professors, and academics in the procession. Dr. Uchenna Ijoma, I hope I'm right, reader, Professor Ngozi Ojinaka, Professor Tola Odetunde, Professor Anthony Ikefuna, Professor Emeritus Professor C.C. Mosu, we recognize him very specially, he's ever present. Dr. Moneke Yube, Dr. Samuel Uwezuke, Professor Herbert Obu, Dr. Bath Chuku, Dr. Kenechuku Ilo, who said our opening prayers, Professor Agozie Ulesie, Dr. Uyasuru Madoka, Dr. Ezemwosu Osita, Dr. Ayuk Adeze, Dr. Ibokwe Uju, Dr. Ilo Ogochukwu, Dr. Mbanefo Ngozi, Dr. Enemuo Ezeamaka, Dr. Obuka Frank, Dr. Ibeneme Chikodile, Dr. Ebele Arono, Professor Ifeoma Enode, Professor Ifeoma Okoye, Professor Emma Obikili, Associate Professor A.U. Kati, Professor C.I. Okafor, Dr. O. Obierim, Dr. Vivian Onukwuli, Dr. Adieke Kenneth, Professor Ifeoma Enemo, past DVC here, former DVC Enugu Campus, Professor Obinna Onyejeku, Director of Research, Professor Emmanuel Ezeonu, Associate Dean of the Faculty, among other dignitaries who are here present. Collectively, please, I will appreciate for all those we have mentioned and those we haven't to please give them a big round of applause for being here present. The family of the inaugural lecturer will be unveiled in due course as we make progress. We are also happy to inform you that the 164th inaugural lecturer is also here witnessing what's going on, because he's going to take up the mantle of presentations directly after the 163rd inaugural presentations. You would have observed that there have been lots of changes brought into the inaugural lecture packaging, all as a result of the innovative and vision of our new Chairman Senate Ceremonials Committee, who is right here with us. Please, let us appreciate Professor Ben Wanguma, BC. Thank you, sir, for the changes, for the innovations. And we'd like to appreciate all those who have joined us online via Zoom. That is also another innovation and keying in into the COVID-19 protocols. Thank you, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, and all here present. I hope you will enjoy the very, very rich packaging in the academic presentations that will center on sustaining healthy kidneys from nascence, the role of the watchmen, as will be presented to us by our 163rd inaugural lecturer, Professor Henrietta Uchenna Okafor. Thank you for listening. I'll be back with more recognitions. But over now to Professor Wanguma, who takes on from there. Professor Wanguma, please.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. May I most respectfully invite the Vice Chancellor for his opening remarks.
Good afternoon, everybody. May I recognize in a special way the Dean of the Faculty of Medical Sciences, the inaugural lecturer here present with the spouse, all your directors and top university management, all the past inaugural lecturers, our emeritus professor and other emeritus professors here, actually I think there are more than one, all the professors, all the heads of departments and units, all the top administrative staff, ladies and gentlemen, and not forgetting the members of the fourth estate of the realm, and all those that are joining us online. It's a great pleasure for me to be here this afternoon to represent our dear Vice Chancellor, who engaged in another university function right now, ongoing. I'm part of the meeting, so I just came out to be here. And the VC has asked me to convey his greetings to you and to let you know that he will also be here personally before the end of this lecture. He had given his word to the lecturer, and he said he will come in to greet us briefly before we are done. So I'm just standing on his behalf to give these opening remarks. And it's a good thing, like the PR, thank you for the beautiful protocol you established. Thank you for the introductions. And also for the reminder that the university is back to one of the things she's known for, and that is inaugural lectures, which is one of the best traditions of any university. And well, I don't know whether it is by design or just by coincidence, but I think maybe because we respect our ladies a lot. We kicked it off in Nsukka last week after more than a year, about a year, and it was a lady. And today again, we are kicking it off here at UNEC, and it's another lady. And that means that when you have ladies in front, it means we are really good to go. We are back and back in full force. And we thank the organizers, especially the chairman of the Senate ceremonials, for being able to bring this function back after nearly 1 year. They have continued to do a good job, and we appreciate them for that. And we appreciate all of us for being here to listen to this very apt lecture that will be coming from one of our own, professor of pediatrics, and she will be talking about sustaining healthy kidney from nascence. And I think this is a lecture that everybody everywhere actually needs to listen to, because the red kidney challenges, well, I don't know whether I call it disease or challenge, she is going to tell us better, but it appears to be on the increase in recent times. And here we are gathered to hear, not from the mouth of a donkey this time around, but the mouth of one who has seen it all, done a lot of research, culminating in her becoming a professor. And today, we are going to drink from her wealth of knowledge. And so we are gathered and we are ready to see what she's going to do with the lecture. Like a couple of years back when I was on a research visit to one of these chums in South Africa, we are just relaxing and watching soccer on the tele. And you know, these commentators sometimes they are funny and sometimes they run out of words, expressions. And there was a particular commentary that got us laughing, because somebody was with the ball and the commentator was like, this person has the ball, what does he do with it? He looks left, he looks right, what does he do? He kicks it. And we started laughing because there's no other thing he would have done other than to kick the ball. And so here we are gathered, and we are sure Professor Okafor is really going to kick the ball and kick it in the right direction. She's going to do what she knows how best to do. And so we thank her for being ready and being available to do justice to it. And thank all of us for coming to learn, to listen, and to be possibly missionaries for this topic. And on this note, I want to formally declare this inaugural lecture open. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Vice Chancellor, sir, for the opening remarks. As the PRO said, a number of people have joined. May I call out members' family who likely to have joined via Zoom for recognition. Mr. Chudi Okafor has joined, he's in Abuja. Mr. Ekene Okafor, the United States. Mrs. Chioma Okoro, the United States. And Mr. Chinedu Okafor in the UK. If you are listening, we're glad to have you participating or listening to the lecture. Next, my pleasure to invite the Dean of the Faculty of Medicine, who is represented by the Associate Dean of the Faculty of Medicine, Professor Emmanuel Ejim, to present and read the citation on the 163rd Inaugural Lecturer of the University of Nigeria. Professor Ejim, please.
The Vice Chancellor, represented by the by Professor Orama, past inaugural lecturers, the 163rd inaugural lecturer, Dr. Henrietta Uche Okafor, and her husband, great lions and lionesses. It's my pleasure to present to you Dr. Henrietta Uchenna Okafor, who was born to the family of late Henry Curtis Chukemwankwo and late Mrs. Christiana Chibozo Nwankwo of Umeji Ufuma in Orumba North local government area of Anambra State. She was the first offspring of her parents and was born in Calabar, Cross River State. She had her nursery and primary education at Santa Maria Catholic School in Aba. She was one of the first entrants into Queen's School, Enugu, immediately after the Civil War, where she had her secondary education. She was admitted into the University of Nigeria and Soka to study medicine in 1974 and graduated at a record time of 6 years in 1980. Post-internship and after her youth service, she joined the services of the University of Nigeria Teaching Hospital as a resident doctor in the pediatrics department of the hospital. After passing her Part 1 fellowship exams, she became the pioneer senior registrar of the just created pediatric nephrology unit under the tutelage of late Professor A.B. Okoro. She successfully scaled through her Part 2 fellowship exams in 1991 and was appointed a lecturer 1 in the Department of Pediatrics of the College of Medicine, University of Nigeria, and subsequently as an honorary consultant pediatrician at the UNTH in 1992. She has some exposure overseas at the renal unit of the Hospital for Sick Children at Great Ormond Street in the United Kingdom in 1996. She was elevated to the rank of a professor of pediatrics in the year 2010, and also an associate research professor at the Nigerian Institute of Medical Research, NIMR, in 2019. Since her appointment, she has served many institutions as an external examiner and is currently an examiner at the National Postgraduate Medical College. She was appointed head of the Department of Pediatrics from the year 2000 to 2003, and subsequently appointed the director of the Institute of Child Health, UNTH, in 2015, and also the foundation director of the newly created Institute of Maternal and Child Health and the College of Medicine, University of Nigeria. Recently, she was awarded a Doctor of Medicine degree by the National Postgraduate Medical College of Nigeria. She initiated the first postgraduate program in maternal and child health in the College of Medicine as the first director of the Institute of Child and Maternal Health. She has great passion for research, and her interests include malaria in children and common pediatric nephrology disorders. Professor Okafor has made some notable achievements as a researcher. She has conducted several clinical trials with anti-malarial as a principal investigator, as well as participated in many studies into malaria and in children. She has also worked as a consultant to agencies like Malaria Consortium, as well as USAID. Indeed, she conducted a trial that informed the change of anti-malarial treatment policy from chloroquine to artemisinin combined ACTs as a national principal investigator in the Southeast Zone. She had researched into malaria in children, both in neonates and in infants. As a pioneer registrar in the pediatric nephrology, she also has a passion for studies pertaining to common kidney diseases in children. Currently, she is the president of the Pediatric Nephrology Association of Nigeria. She has tried to establish the pattern locally, and as president, is facilitating the establishment of a renal registry for children in Nigeria. This will help to ascertain the burden in our country. She has more than 100 publications in peer-reviewed journals to her credit. She has served in various capacities, both in the faculty and university committees. Professor Okafor is happily married with 4 children, and she's a devout Christian and a lady of Semolumba. She enjoys aerobics and dancing. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you the 163rd inaugural lecturer of the University of Nigeria, Professor Henrietta Uchenna Okafor.
The chairman of the occasion, the Vice Chancellor, University of Nigeria, Professor Charles Igwe, ably represented by the Deputy Vice Chancellor, Academic, Professor Johnson Orama, the Deputy Vice Chancellor, University of Nigeria Enugu campus, my friend, Professor Edith Nwosu. She's not here, but I know she'll be eventually come. Other principal officers of the university. Other principal officers of the university, the Provost College of Medicine, Professor Uchenwaga, who is not yet here, the Dean, Faculty of Medical Sciences, Professor Kajetan Onyedum, ably represented by Professor Ejim. Present. Bennett Wanguma. Temporal. My most revered past inaugural lecturers, professors and colleagues, lions and lionesses, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. I really thank God that this day has finally come. This lecture was supposed to be held more than a year ago, but was interrupted by the pandemic and the industrial action within the university system. It saddens me that some of the people I invited who were supposed to be here, and some of them that played a very important role in my career, lost their lives last year. So, for those of us that are here today, I think it's only by the special grace of God that we are here. It's not by our power. It's not by our might. The title of my lecture is Sustaining Healthy Kidneys from Nascence, the Role of Watchmen. For those of you that have worked closely with me, this is a subject that is very close to my heart. I have great passion for kidney diseases in children. I even took a quote from the Bible, which says, if when he seeth the sword come upon the land, he blows the trumpet and warns the people. That is what I am trying to do today, because it is a mandate from God. The outline of my lecture will be, I'll give a short background telling you how I got to this stage in my career. Then I'll take you through certain things that led to the genesis of this title, the scope of kidney disease globally and locally, development of the kidneys, how it works, the common disorders in children, the role of genetics, other risk factors. Then you all help me decide who these watchmen should be and what their roles should be. And what their roles should actually be. I've dedicated this lecture to all Nigerian children with kidney disease and their parents, because I've worked with this group for over 30 years. So my heart goes out to them. This lecture is not just an inaugural lecture. I think it's an opportunity to give an account of my stewardship as the caretaker of the pediatric nephrology unit of the University of Nigeria Teaching Hospital for the past 30 years. It's a legacy set by my mentor, late Professor B.A. Okoro, who established that unit, worked tirelessly to
to foster and nurture it. It also gives me an opportunity to unveil certain facts about a silent scourge, which I feel, if it's not addressed in time, portends imminent danger to our society. I will seize the opportunity also to highlight the causes of suffering in this group of children. Basically, general lack of knowledge, disarray in our health system, and the harsh economic circumstances in the country. Let me take you back a step towards my memory lane. In the year 1983, I did join the residency program in pediatrics. About the same time, the pediatric nephrology unit was established. The head of department at the time, Professor J.C. Azubike, posted me to the unit to start it off with my mentor. We both tried to establish the subspecialty service and build up our clientele. We ensured adequate services within the limits of available resources at the time. Now, why did I remain in that subspecialty? I realized the magnitude of the problem and that there was a gap in the subspecialty service. I noted the poor outcome despite the very hard work we did, with very high mortality rates at the time. It was a challenge. I also observed the financial constraints of the caregivers and the kind of questions they asked. They often wondered whether children also had kidney disease, which revealed a lot of ignorance out there. And then the despair which they often experience, which often led them, you know, to take their discharge against medical advice. A couple once told me, after explaining to them about the condition of their child, they told me they were going to go home, that they would rather go home and make another child than spend all they had on this one child in the hospital. That saddened me a great deal. However, over time, more residents came into the unit and we started expanding. However, some of them will just peep at us and run away because they couldn't stand the mental trauma. But some of us remained. We are all here today. However, the unit suffered a major setback in the year 2004, and that was due to the demise of my mentor, Professor A.B. Okoro. I felt like an orphan at that point. However, I felt also challenged to sustain the legacy he left. Today, I'm happy to inform you that unit has actually expanded to include 5 consultants, 2 professors, 1 associate professor, 1 senior lecturer, and 1 lecturer one. We're expecting 2 more professors very soon. We've mentored and trained pediatric nephrologists who are practicing in various parts of the country, especially the Southeast. Some of them are here today. And it may interest you to know that at the time I joined the service, there were less than 10 pediatric nephrologists in Nigeria. That is, consultants, pediatricians, taking care of children with kidney diseases. But today in our associations, we have a strength of more than 60. So based on my observations and experience from caring for this group of children over the past 3 decades. Certain things struck me. Just like the DVC said, increasing number of children with kidney diseases, both locally and globally, are deteriorating health services, the poor infrastructure with lack of human and material resources, the worsening economic situation, which has plunged all of us into poverty. But most importantly, the total neglect and marginalization of children when it comes to renal care. There's inadequate provision of materials and resources for the management of children with kidney diseases. When I say this, I mean in terms of equipment, consumables for pediatric renal care, and other resources. I took my time and I asked hospitals, both public and private hospitals, if there's any center where there's a dedicated renal unit for children. I couldn't find any. Rather, you see us begging the adult unit to give us space to dialyze our patients. It's quite disheartening. I also noticed inequities with respect to access to renal replacement therapy, which means dialysis and renal transplantation. In a recent textbook, Worldwide Nephrology, we made a contribution about Nigeria, nephrology practice in Nigeria. And in that textbook, we noted that more than 500 transplants had been done in Nigeria over the past 3 to 4 years. But these were mostly in adults. Less than 10 transplants have been done in children within the country. Somebody may look at it casually and say maybe children don't actually need, you know, renal transplant. But that is not true. Children that require renal transplants are there, they're out there. And in fact, in children, we recommend you transplant them earlier for a better outcome. I also observed the poor health-related quality of life and high cost of services. In a study we carried out on children who had the commonest type of renal disorder, globally and locally, the nephrotic syndrome, we looked at the quality of life of these children and we saw that it was quite low. In chronic diseases, you know, you're not just interested in treating the patient, you know, to take care of the symptoms. You want to know what is the quality of life of that child. And it was observed that the quality of life of these children were quite low. Our colleague in Lagos even looked at the quality of life of the caregivers, that's the parents of these children, and found that it was equally low. And personally, I'm suggesting that the quality of life of the doctors that look after these children should also be looked into, because we suffer a lot of mental stress, emotional stress, managing these children, feeling so helpless, you know, when we come across them. All these were compounded by unaffordable costs of services in the absence of subsidies or insurance coverage, which is the normal thing in developed countries. I then took a cursory look at the trajectory of our health sector and the economy over the past 3 decades. It was quite discouraging with regards to funding of curative or even supportive services for this group of patients. One of our colleagues tried to analyze, you know, the cost implications of renal care in Nigeria. And it was not encouraging at all. when you remember that about 60 to 70% or more of our population live below the poverty line, and our minimum wage is still below $3, less than 5% of the population are covered by health insurance, and only a proportion of the working class have access to this health insurance. And even those that have the health insurance, care for patients with chronic kidney disease or end-stage renal disease is not accommodated, because the health insurance as it is now only covers 6 sessions. That's 2 weeks of dialysis. But a patient that has chronic kidney disease will dialyze for life. Now, Nigeria also has the highest health-related out-of-pocket expenditure. So the cost, economic burden, is on the individual. Not to talk of the high rates of unemployment. Compared to other low and medium income countries in the world, Nigeria actually has one of the highest out-of-pocket expenditure for health. So, ladies and gentlemen, generally one can, you know, say that renal replacement therapy is not accessible in Nigeria. In present-day Nigeria, I'm tempted to say that a diagnosis of kidney disease or failure is like a death sentence. This is even worse for children, as you'll see in our publication. The children depend on their parents to pay their bills. Remember, they don't have money. And the parents that will pay the bills are those that say they'll go and make more children and leave the one that is ill. Most of our health services are commercialized, even in the public health facilities. When I started off my residency, treatment for children was usually free. Even where they have to pay, they don't pay as much as adults. But right now, everything is commercialized. And if your the unit is not generating enough revenue, nothing is given to that unit. It's so sad that we've thrown away social responsibility, which I believe that's what it should be for children. An editorial report on end-stage renal disease in sub-Saharan Africa revealed that all forms of renal replacement therapy is virtually out of reach of the common man in Africa. With regards to kidney transplant, we looked at the current status of kidney transplantation in Nigerian children. And we found that the access rate for Nigerian children is less than 0.2%. So it is not that children don't require transplant. They do require transplant, but the access rate is 0.2%. And poor funding is a major challenge. We did recommend in that publication that there is an urgent need for the federal government to fund healthcare, and particularly kidney transplantation. In our review of patients that pass through our units, we looked at access to dialysis. Out of the patients that required dialysis in our units, only 39% were able to access it. And when I say access it, it's not that it's optimal care. It may be just one or two sessions, and the money will finish. So generally, looking at the economic burden of chronic kidney disease in developed countries, a country like United States of America spends almost $100 billion United States dollars in form of subsidies and insurance, taking care of individuals with chronic kidney disease and end-stage renal failure. Let's come back home. In Nigeria, Southeast Nigeria, a session of dialysis costs about 35,000 naira, and a minimum of 3 sessions are required for optimum care. That's about 105,000 naira a week. Remember, we have a minimum wage of less than $3 a year, and this is exclusive of medication and laboratory tests. Renal transplantation costs about 10 million naira just for the procedure, while the investigations and drug treatment cost an additional 2 to 3 million, and that is for life. So these exorbitant costs amidst the mounting prevalence, incidence, and mortality of kidney diseases in both adults and children calls for concern. Why am I particularly interested in children with chronic kidney disease in this country? I believe the situation is more serious for us in Nigeria, being the most populous country in Africa, and we are said to have a youthful population. More than 50% of our population comprised of children under the age of 18 years. And tracking studies have confirmed that children with certain predisposing factors eventually end up with chronic kidney disease and failure later in life. So it is obvious that whatever happens to children in Nigeria will translate to a very non-productive adult population. So it is something the country should take seriously. Global burden of kidney diseases. Right now, all over the world, kidney disease is regarded as a public health priority. I believe Nigeria should follow suit because 850 million people are said to be living with kidney disease worldwide. Kidney disease in 2016 was the 13th leading cause of death in the whole world, and it's projected that by the year 2040, it's going to be the fifth leading cause of death. There's increase globally, both in incidence and prevalence. But it is important to know that this burden has been noted to be greater in developing countries like ours. So we should take it more seriously. A systematic review in Nigeria revealed that about 1 in 10 Nigerians has chronic kidney disease. So if we are like 300 here, 30 people here already have chronic kidney disease. And Nigeria is one of the countries with more than 10 million cases of chronic kidney disease, according to a recent report that was released last year. Here in UNTH, we noted that 4% of all our pediatric hospital admissions were due to chronic kidney disease. That was an earlier study. Subsequent study showed an increase in the number of patients with chronic kidney disease. In terms of mortality, it's also increasing exponentially. So we need to do something about it. In Africa, it is said that the extent of the burden of kidney disease is imprecise, and I'll tell you why. There are no registries. You know, we don't document properly. We don't have adequate documentation. All these figures that we are mentioning from Nigeria are based on pockets of hospital-based studies. And who are the patients we see in the hospitals? These are patients who are very ill. But those that have the earlier stages of chronic kidney diseases are the ones that you find in the communities. So we often say that what you're seeing is just a tip of the iceberg. So an urgent intervention is needed. We need, you know, to change our way of thinking and think towards prevention, preventive nephrology. Now, the epidemiology occurrence of kidney diseases has been found to be heterogeneous. You find that it occurs in clusters, maybe in families, in certain races. For us here, we've noticed that most of our patients actually come from Nsukka zone. So if it were a country where these things are taken seriously, this should be investigated, because it is now known that certain factors contribute to this chronic kidney disease and even try to increase the rapidity of progression to end stage. So this heterogeneity, like I said, has been linked to genetic predisposition, lifestyle of a group of people, exposure to certain drugs, chemicals, environmental and social related factors. Disparities have also been noted in the course of chronic kidney disease in children. While chronic kidney disease in the developed world is usually due to congenital abnormalities of the kidneys, in these parts, it's said to be as a result of acquired causes, mainly infectious diseases, communicable diseases, but we still do find some congenital abnormalities. Maybe we've not looked hard enough. So my thoughts, ladies and gentlemen, is that because of this deterioration over time, preventive nephrology is the only way to go. We should invest on preventive measures and interventions. Hence, I chose this title, Sustaining Healthy Kidneys from Nascence. So we should go back to Nascence and see, you know, is there anything we can actually do to curb this scourge? And then we should also look at those who are the watchmen. What are the roles they're actually supposed to be play? So let's look at the kidneys. What are these kidneys? The kidneys are two fist-sided organs, the right one slightly lower than the left one. In actual fact, an individual can live out their whole lifespan with just one kidney. And that's why kidney donation is being encouraged. Now, what are the functions of the kidneys? The kidneys cleanse the blood and the internal environment of the body so that the other organs can also perform optimally. This is important because we looked at, again, children with nephrotic syndrome, whom were stable and being followed up in the clinic. We decided to look at their cardiac function and found that almost 90% of them already have abnormal cardiac function, maybe because of their kidney disorder. The kidneys also help to form blood cells. So when the kidneys are bad, you find that the individual will be anemic. Even the formation of the bones, you know. So when you have bad kidneys, the bones may not be strong enough again. So that shows you how important the kidneys are. This just shows you what the kidneys do. the blood with all the toxins we consume, both the ones we inhale, all the rubbish we take that gets into the bloodstream, it gets to the kidneys, and the kidneys will filter away all those toxins and discharge them through the urine and then return the clean blood to the body. So that if anything is wrong with the kidneys, there's accumulation of these waste products in the body. This is what a good kidney looks like. And then you can see on the right a diseased kidney. So let's look at the development of the kidneys. I'm going back, taking you back to development of the kidneys so that we can actually see where we can intervene when it comes to prevention. By the fourth month of pregnancy, the baby in the womb has already started producing urine. And this urine, you know, although the kidneys are not mature at that time, but this urine also contributes to the liquor, that's the water that surrounds the baby in the womb. The importance of this fact is that if there is anything wrong with the kidney, you find that the baby doesn't make urine and the volume of liquor is not adequate. And this can be detected very early while the baby is in the womb, because early intervention also helps to preserve and sustain the kidneys. Okay? So you find that all those ultrasound we do to check the gender of the baby, we might as well do it to check the renal flow tract of the baby and see whether the baby is actually making enough urine. So that is a way we can intervene. By the 36th week of pregnancy, that's between the 8th and 9th month of pregnancy, you find that the kidneys are already mature. So the kidneys mature by the 36th week of pregnancy. Now, the importance of this is that in premature babies, you find that the kidneys are not actually mature. Although they may grow, the kidneys may grow, but that growth after birth is not usually normal. So premature babies should be monitored. Their renal function should be monitored and their kidneys should be protected. It is only by the second year of life that the kidney function is now comparable to that of an adult. So at birth, both each kidney has about 1 million functional units. But these units, if anything happens to any of them, they don't regenerate. Rather, if anything damages them, the remaining units will work harder. And this is what we call hyperfiltration. This hard work is self-destructive, because as the units are working harder, they are also damaging themselves. And if care is not taken, this will cause progression to kidney failure. So the importance of this is that if a baby is born with a low number of nephrons, low number of functional units, it means that that baby is predisposed to chronic kidney disease and kidney failure. So our duty is now to find out what are those things that will make a baby to be born with less number of functional units. A lot of factors have been identified. Some of them genetic, others epigenetic. In fact, since the advent of epigenesis and its role in chronic kidney disease in children, it has given some hope. Because epigenesis means that there are certain factors in the womb, certain external factors which may affect the way, you know, the kidneys are formed, and that these factors, if you can remove them, you can actually do something and prevent that abnormal formation of the kidneys. So indeed, chronic kidney disease is a progressive condition, and once it is initiated, it progresses to end-stage renal failure. If you look at the bottom of that slide, you can see the progression to end-stage renal failure. The stage 5 is the stage at which you now require dialysis or renal transplantation. A lot of theories have been propounded. The developmental programming theory, which is also linked to the epigenesis theory, which shows that certain chemicals or an abnormal environment within the womb can actually lead to abnormal formation of the kidney. So a mother that uses cocaine is likely to have an abnormal baby. A mother that uses alcohol early in pregnancy is likely to have a baby with abnormal kidneys. A mother that takes high or low salt, or very low salt, can also have abnormal kidneys. So these are some of the factors that have been identified. Even drugs, even some antihypertensive drugs. This is for the doctors. Some of these drugs, that's the angiotensin-converting enzyme inhibitors, if taken in pregnancy, can actually affect the formation of the kidneys and lead to abnormal kidneys at birth. So here in UNTH, we looked at the distribution of kidney diseases in our children, and we found that 1.4% of our patients had congenital abnormalities of the kidneys. And when compared to other centers in the country, you find that it's virtually the same pattern. You have most of the centers, the commonest condition they saw was nephrotic syndrome, just like us here. And then most of the conditions were acquired. The abnormal conditions the babies are born with are quite low. Maybe we've not looked hard enough. So globally, congenital abnormalities of the kidneys and urinary tract constitute more than 30% of all congenital malformations. And locally, the figures we have shown a rising trend, but at a lower level. One of the commonest conditions we see here is the posterior urethral valve. Now, there are other theories with regards to, you know, the congenital abnormalities of the kidneys. Some people have suggested that malnutrition in the mother, either over or under nutrition or low protein intake, can also lead to a lower number of functional units. Even some micronutrients like iron, folate, you know, deficiency in mothers have also been linked up to a lower number of functional units. Currently, genetics has also been found to play a very crucial role. Genetics in the sense that African Americans have been shown to have a particular gene known as the APOL1 gene, which predisposes them to chronic kidney disease. Incidentally, this particular gene has also been identified in Nigeria, certain variants of it, you know, an old study done in Southwest, even here, our own Professor Lassie, has done a lot of work on the APOL1 gene, and studies are ongoing. And that is what the H3 Africa study is all about, both in children and in adults. Studies in East Africa have actually shown that certain variants of this APOL1 gene can lead to chronic kidney disease in black African children. This APOL1 gene actually, these variants are actually supposed to protect us from sleeping sickness. But incidentally, it now predisposes us to kidney disease. So this is, I just put in this to highlight the issue of epigenesis so that we can see the points. The picture you see there is the DNA, which is the genetic blueprint for the human cell. And those filamentous things are the areas where, you know, if some adverse factors lead to some chemical reaction, can actually affect the ways the genes are expressed. And all these have been implicated in the occurrence of congenital abnormalities of the kidneys. Now, we try to review, you know, the role of, the possible role of epigenetics in pediatric kidney disease, and did recommend that epigenetics may have prospects in preventive nephrology through interventions in the early stages of pregnancy. And this is an area to be explored. Now, let us look at some of the congenital abnormalities of the kidneys and urinary tract. What we call the posterior urethral valves is one of the commonest conditions which we see. And the posterior urethral valves, what it does is that it obstructs the flow of urine. If you look at the extreme right, that is a kidney that has posterior urethral valves. You have obstruction, you have back, you know, pressure of urine, dilatation, it goes right up to the kidneys and destroys the kidney. We are seeing more cases right now, and the pediatric surgeons will bear us out. Now, this condition, if identified even in the womb or at birth, and the obstruction is relieved, you know, it can actually help the kidneys, sustain the kidneys, you know, longer. And it manifests with an interrupted urinary stream. You find that the child, it occurs mainly in male children, and the child doesn't pass urine very well. The urine doesn't come in a continuous stream. So this is an area where one can also intervene. Our mothers should check the urinary stream of their babies, you know. But most of them will tell you that their babies wear pampers and they don't know whether the baby's urine stream is normal or not. We found that most of our patients with this condition, they have a very poor outcome, and we looked at the determinants of outcome in the patients, and we found that the problem is that they come late. The mothers do not bring them to hospital in time, or they shop around for treatment in other centers. Other doctors may not know the implication of that that condition, because at times it comes with urinary tract infection. So we found that late presentation is one of the causes of poor outcome. And this is another place we can intervene. More education of the mothers, more education of other health workers can help. Another congenital anomaly of the kidney, which we often see, is what we call the solitary kidney. Remember I told you that an individual can live with just one kidney. However, in some cases, when that kidney is diseased, it may be fatal. In this case, we reported a patient with lobar pneumonia, and we were battling with the patient. The patient went into kidney failure, and we lost that patient. At that time, we were still doing autopsies in the hospital. So we did an autopsy on the patient, and we discovered that the patient actually had just one kidney, had a solitary kidney. This seven-year-old child also came with deformity of the spine. And this deformity was associated also with passage of blood and stones in urine. On further investigations, we realized that this child had actually one kidney. So it can present in various ways. So we need a high index of suspicion. And such patients should be referred to the specialists. We don't try to, the general practitioners or health workers should not try to manage them. Once you see such cases, they should be referred. Now, I mentioned that the commonest disorder we see in children is the nephrotic syndrome. This is, in most of our series, is the highest number of patients. And it's like this all over the world. Because its presentation is very dramatic, you find the children get so bloated up, and the parents are alarmed, and they start rushing to the hospital. Nephrotic syndrome was one of the commonest causes of hospital admission at a point. And we found that it has a higher mortality in children with sickle cell disease. And most of them progress rapidly to end-stage renal disease. Now, one thing about nephrotic syndrome is that if you treat it, it gets better, but it keeps on, they keep on relapsing. So we now try to look at what causes this, triggers these relapses. In developed countries, they've been able to find out that certain respiratory infections can trigger off the relapses. And they give drugs, like they give vaccines to, you know, avert that. But here we've been able to notice that some of them have relapses when they have fever. Some others will tell you, once they treat malaria, that the patient gets better. So in our series, we thought that malaria ranked second as a possible trigger for relapse in these patients. Another condition is acute streptococcal glomerulonephritis, tongue-twisting term. It's another common condition, and it follows skin infections and sore throats. You may think that the skin infections children have, that they are not important. This can actually lead to kidney disease. And a researcher recently linked this childhood condition with chronic kidney disease in adults and suggested that preventive strategies to reduce scabies and skin infections may actually reduce this burden. Then we have what we now call acute kidney injury, formerly acute renal failure. This is very important. It is quite common in our environment. In these days of emerging and re-emerging diseases, infectious diseases, you find that many of these patients, even COVID, you know, the mortalities we have now from these diseases, Lassa fever and all, the final pathway is acute kidney injury. That's injury to the kidneys. But one thing that has been found out is that those of them that even survive eventually, you know, develop chronic kidney disease. So even when they survive, you still need to monitor them. In a study we carried out here, we found that children that came into the emergency room, about 56% of them had acute kidney injury. It's because we looked out for it, that was why we saw it. And remember that we don't have facilities. If you look at the picture there, we improvise, you can even see a waterproof bag. that we used to improvise, you know, as a bag, a container for the fluid we used to dialyze the patient. So our best bet is to avoid all these conditions, you know, because it is said that if identified early, simple interventions may actually reverse the situation. We should look at the common causes of this acute kidney injury. I'm sure we remember the My Pekin saga, where there was contamination of a teething powder. A lot of infants died, and they died because they had acute kidney injury, which, you know, the hospitals didn't have facilities to dialyze them. Like I said, children are being marginalized, so they lost their lives. There are other things, toxins to the kidneys, which we commonly abuse. Drugs like ibuprofen, you know, should be used carefully. It's not a drug to be abused because it can have an adverse effect on the kidneys. For us in pediatrics, malaria has been found to be an important cause of acute kidney injury. Urinary tract infections. Somebody asked me the other day during an interview, do children have urinary tract infections? Where do they get it from? It is quite common in children. One of the first studies I did on primary school children, you know, normal, that had no symptoms, I found that about 2% of them already have urinary tract infections. And these infections are more serious in children because once it gets to the kidneys itself, it can cause scarring. And you find the kidneys are shrunken. And once they are shrunken, it can lead to hypertension and then progressive damage to end-stage renal disease. Even a study that was done here by one of us, who is sitting right before me here, you know, we found that children that came to the clinic with fever, who under normal circumstances will say it's malaria, you know, we looked at their urine and we found that these children, 11% of them have urinary infection. So all fevers in children are not due to malaria. And this is a point of where we can intervene. Anybody treating or seeing a child with fever should also look at the urine to exclude urinary tract infection. There are some high-risk groups, sickle cell disease patients, they have more of it. Adolescents have more of urinary tract infection. So these risk groups should also occasionally be screened. So you find that there are various factors which can actually lead to chronic kidney disease in children, right from the womb. That's from Nascence. You see, from the womb, the child may have low endowment of functional units. And then during infancy and childhood, factors like, I didn't even mention obesity, can lead to hypertension, acute kidney injury. And you find that there's more damage to the functional units. Remember I said the functional units do not regenerate. So it's just a progressive loss of those functional units and overwork of the remaining one, which is self-destructive. So there are various stages where you can really intervene. You can, in normal individuals, you can screen to see if there are risk factors. If there are risk factors, you can screen to see if there's chronic kidney disease. If there's chronic kidney disease, it means there's damage. You should now institute treatment, you know, to slow down progression. And you should identify when the patient gets to the last stage. And that is when you institute your renal replacement therapy. So there are so many risk factors, both of them, some of them modifiable, some non-modifiable. The non-modifiable ones are those caused by genetic predisposition. But you find that in our environment, there are so many things we can do, you know, to at least stop those ones that are, remove those ones that are modifiable. For instance, low birth weight has been associated with low nephron endowment, that's lower number of nephrons and chronic kidney disease. Children that are small for gestational age, they are predisposed to it. Mothers that are take drugs, cocaine, alcohol, obesity, low salt diet, low protein diet. So these are some of the risk factors. Even traditional medicines, herbal concoction, some of these teas, you know, we take, we don't know what they contain. Even dehydration. These days, the weather is so hot, and if we don't hydrate ourselves very well, we are predisposed to kidney disease. So there are so many things that we can do, you know, to curb the prevalence. Because for us in Nigeria, you can see we cannot afford to fund the curative measures or treatments. So it's better we invest on prevention. And that is where we now have to look at who are the watchmen and what can they do. In public health, we know that there are three levels of prevention. You have the primary level, you have the secondary level, and you have the tertiary level. I believe that at each of these levels, that there are watchmen who can actually intervene. This year's World Kidney Day said, living well with kidney disease, but also emphasizes the importance of kidney health. But I think the theme for last year's World Kidney Day campaign is more relevant to what I'm saying today. You know, the need to strive for kidney health for everyone, everywhere, every age, from prevention to early detection to easy access to health. And it laid specific, you know, emphasis on preventive interventions to avert the onset and progression of kidney disease. So who are the key players? We look at the key players are the government, the policy makers, the ministries, development partners, the media, health workers, specialists, general practitioners, and even self. We owe it to ourselves, you know, to take care of our kidneys. So, at the level of primary prevention, what can the policymakers do? They should be able to facilitate access to health services, provide a safe environment, provide food security, poverty alleviation, because if the mothers eat healthy, they are unlikely to produce babies that are predisposed to kidney failure. So the government needs to enact laws to emphasize and make sure that these things are achieved. Then encourage a healthy lifestyle, the media, rather than advertise products that we know that are damaging to the kidneys. We should lay emphasis on a healthy lifestyle, reduce salt intake, reduce the use of seasonings that are very salty, you know, encourage an active lifestyle, and discourage adverts of kidney damaging products. Things like bleaching creams, which contain hydroxyquinone, you know, these are known to damage the kidneys. Mercury containing soaps, policymakers with regards to secondary prevention, which is actually early detection, should integrate screening services into school health programs and facilitate screening for at-risk groups. Specialists like obstetricians, I already said, do your antenatal ultrasound to screen for urinary obstruction. And for those that practice assisted reproduction techniques, you should restrict the number of babies so that the birth weight will not be compromised, because low birth weight has been associated with chronic kidney diseases. Pediatricians and general practitioners should insist on urine tests on children at the facility level. Measure the blood pressure of children. Some people often ask, do children have high blood pressure? Of course they do. When we go for our screening programs, we find that children in secondary schools have blood pressure as high as 200 and are walking around with it. You know, so we adopt that practice of measuring blood pressure in children and have a high index of suspicion for acute kidney injury whenever we see a sick child. Always ask whether that child is making urine. Restrict the use of drugs like ibuprofen when you have sick children. If you do, monitor the kidney function. Remember, every fever is not malaria. Then for us pediatric nephrologists, we should be able to come up with protocols and guidelines which everybody should adhere to. Periodically, we should look at the outcome of those guidelines and protocols and see if there's any way we can revise them. We should also establish follow-up clinics to monitor kidney function in high-risk groups like these low birth weight babies, asphyxiated babies, small for gestational age babies, babies with congenital heart defects, sickle cell anemia patients. We should monitor their kidney functions. Caregivers, these are the mothers. You have to open your eyes. Always check whether your baby is making urine, especially when the baby is sick. If it is a male baby, check whether the stream of urine is normal. Check the color of the urine. A study on caregivers revealed that less than 50% knew that an interrupted urinary stream indicates an abnormality in the urinary tract. Then for tertiary prevention, I've already highlighted that earlier on, the marginalization of children. We need to equip hospitals with facilities for both dialysis and kidney transplants for both adults and children. And we should look at subsidies for patients with renal problem and make our health insurance scheme more comprehensive to accommodate them. And also, under tertiary prevention, we should support renal transplantation and allied services and make it all inclusive. We should look at cadaveric transplant, because what we are doing now, we are doing live donor transplants. We should also ensure availability of drugs at reasonable costs and support local manufacturers to manufacture generics. Invest on training of skilled workforce for renal replacement therapies. So the way forward is preventive nephrology and subsidies for treatment of renal disorders in children. So these are my areas of future research. I'm really interested in the role of epigenetics in congenital anomalies, especially posterior urethral valves, which we are seeing a lot of it. I'm concerned about the deterioration of renal function in children whom we are following up. Whenever they get to adolescence, their renal function dips. So I hope I have sensitized you enough as watchmen, because I believe all of us here are the watchmen, and all hands should be on deck. And I conclude by saying that children's kidneys do matter. Don't forget this. So wherever you can, you know, you should also help us plead to the government, to the policy makers, and tell them that they should provide facilities for the management of kidney diseases in children. This is my team during one of the World Kidney Day campaigns. So I would like to seize this opportunity again to thank God for giving me the opportunity to achieve all that I have done up to this stage in my life. And I would like to acknowledge the contribution of certain key individuals who motivated and molded me along my career. I must acknowledge my late father, who was my role model as a medical practitioner. He contributed immensely to my resolve to become a doctor. And although he did not support my being a doctor, he felt it was too stressful. Then I would like to also acknowledge and thank my family, my daughter and her family. She was one of us here, but she's now abroad, for all their support. My first son, for his support. That's with his new wife. I thank them for all the support they've been giving me, especially towards the preparation for this lecture. My other son and his family in the US, it's unfortunate that because of the COVID pandemic, they cannot come back. And this is the baby of the family, you know. He just left the country and he cannot make it back for this. And I cannot forget my mentor, Professor A.B. Okoro, because, and in fact, he had a pet name for me, Adamazi. That's what he used to call me. And he dragged me along and ensured that I got interested in pediatric nephrology. And of course, I have to thank my dear husband here for all his support from secondary, from my university days, you know, throughout residency. I thank him. He's a boyfriend, he's a partner, he's everything to me. Thank you very much. And then I must acknowledge some other key individuals. Professor J.C. Azubike of blessed memory. Professor Azubike made me, in fact, realize that I had joined a residency program. He virtually forced me to take the primary exams in pediatrics. Professors P.O. Okonkwo, Rich Ume, Ezedayina Chi, Professor Salako of blessed memory, they laid the foundation of clinical research in my life. To all the agencies that I worked for, the Federal Ministry of Health, DFID, etc., they gave me the exposure required as a researcher. And I'm highly indebted to my pediatric nephrology team at UNTH for all the support. And not just pediatric nephrology, the adult nephrologists, because we actually grew up together. Professor Okoro always dragged all of us together, and we grew up as a family, you know. So I like to thank the members of the LOC who put all this together. I know it's, you know, it's quite stressful. It's like doing it twice, you know, but I resolved that this lecture must take place because it was postponed for more than a year. So I thank them for getting together once more and work tirelessly and selflessly. You know, you were a formidable team. Thank you so much. I'd like to express My thanks to the chairman of the ceremonials committee for his support. When the lecture was postponed, he kept on reassuring me, you know, consoling me that it will eventually take place. And I thank him for all his support with his team, Mrs. Sedik, and all of them, they were great. To my family, my extended family members who are here, can they stand up for recognition, please? You know, my in-laws, my friends who are here. I really thank you. I thank you for being here. I really thank you for your support, you know. Thank you so much. And all my friends, my classmates who are here, the 80 class, thank you so much for being here with me. They're all here, my classmates in med school. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Please sit. The Vice Chancellor would make his post-lecture remarks and make a presentation to the inaugural lecturer on behalf of the university.
Well, it's been a very great day, and I don't think it could have been better than this. And maybe that attests to the fact that it took an extra 1 year to prepare for this lecture. You know, when you think you're already prepared, that you are given one more year to go and prepare. And we can see the outcome. And we really thank her. We thank her and we thank her again. Thank you so much for that wonderful lecture. Thank you. It's an eye-opener. And in short, there are too many takeaways. If I begin to go through that, I think I'll need another 1 hour of lecture to go through all the takeaways. But some of the key points are that children's kidneys do matter. And we really need to go out as watchmen, as ambassadors, and also do everything possible about preventive nephrology, which, of course, we always know that prevention is better than cure. And is a sermon, is a lecture, is everything for us to go out and do everything within our powers. The only challenge, I know that if we had room for discussions, maybe even another 6 hours would not have been enough to discuss this paper, because like the generation we find ourselves in, where food is no longer prepared the traditional way our mothers, our grandmothers used to cook, you know. They used to prepare these things natural, but these days we are just mixing chemicals. Everything is already prepared, and you just throw this, throw that, throw this seasoning, because one of the things she talked about was about seasonings, and this is a generation where we just throw seasonings together, and our soup or our food is ready. And we just pray that God will help us to be more careful about, you know, the lifestyle we live, what we eat, what we drink, what we do, because one way or the other, either it affects our kidneys as children, or it affects our kidney as adults, or it affects the kidney of our children. And so we really want to appreciate again for that. And I know we have all listened very attentively. And it's for us to go home and begin to put into practice those things we've had. And it may also interest us to know that so many people joined this lecture online. At the last count, we had about 150 persons joining online, and not only from Nigeria, but from different parts of the world. And that is quite heartwarming. And I'm sure that those who joined online have also enjoyed the lecture as much as those of us that are here. And on that note, as we thank the lecturer, we also want to present this plaque on behalf of the University of Nigeria as a testimony that on this day, she delivered the 163rd inaugural lecture of the University of Nigeria, Nsukka. Thank you very much. Okay, and there is also a certificate to show that she really did that. And so on behalf of the University of Nigeria, we also present this certificate showing that she presented a lecture on sustaining healthy kidneys from Nascence, the role of Watchmen, on the 22nd day of April 2021. Congratulations. And like we said, so many people, almost equal number of people, I don't know how many we have there, but told us we have about 150 joining online, and some of your friends also who could not make it to this place. We know they will need this lecture, and so we are presenting these copies so that you can give to your friends who are not able to come here, or those who join the online, or those that you want to be recruited as watchmen too. So thank you very much, and we pray that as we all listen, we'll take the message home, and we shall all continue to be watchmen. Thank you for recruiting us as watchmen. And we thank everybody for being here and for listening attentively and for accepting to go home and be watchmen. Thank you.
Madam, please sit down. Thank you very much. Thank you, the Vice Chancellor. The Public Relations Officer will give the vote of thanks and take further recognitions. Thank you.
Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, our VC. We would like to appreciate our 163rd inaugural lecturer in a special way for her beauty and brains. Thank you, my prof. Thank you so very much. And we can't express less gratitude anyway to the husband who's been a pillar of support, Chief Sir Chude Okafor. We thank you once again for letting us have her for today at this inaugural lecture. And while going on the appreciations, we'd like to acknowledge Professor Fidelis Ejizie, who joined us in the course of this. He's the Dean, Faculty of Basic Medical Sciences. Professor Ejizie, thank you for coming too. And actually, we had introduced Professor Emmanuel Ejim, the Associate Dean, and he's representing the Dean in full capacity at this event. So we want to recognize him in that capacity. Professor Emmanuel Ejim, representing the Dean of the Faculty. Thank you, sir. Our vote of thanks will specially go to those who found time, more for those who found time to be here, and equally for those who found time to join us online. Quite a good number of them, close to 150 from all over the world who joined us on this 163rd inaugural lecture presentation on the theme. This is quite outstanding. More so, the innovation we brought in to bear, courtesy the Chairman of Senior Ceremonials Committee, who's made this impactful. We thank all those who joined us online and were able to stay on all through the lectures till this very particular moment. And those of us who found time, friends, relations, who found time to be here, the Vice Chancellor actually had expressed great regard and even in the acknowledgement of the inaugural lecturer, she also had also acknowledged quite a good number of hands that lend to the full progress packaging of this 163rd inaugural lecture. So, most importantly, our gratitude finally will go to the Almighty God who's kept us alive all through the pandemic to also wait patiently for this glorious time to listen to this very exciting message. I think for us now as gatekeepers, it's even more interesting when you listen to lectures like this and you're already advanced in age and knowing that there were things we would have done if we knew some of the things we didn't know before. And that's why it's even more important, even as parents, to mentor our siblings, mentor our children with the knowledge we have expanded as it has been listening to Professor Henrietta Uchenna Okafor, who has talked to us very extensively on sustaining healthy kidneys from Nascence. And as watchmen, whom we now identify ourselves to be, I think there's a lot to take home, just as been highlighted by the Vice Chancellor. The vote of thanks will be inconclusive if we fail to mention even the technical crew and those who made it possible, even within the difficult terrain we found ourselves in at Moot Court, to get the signals across to the world. Please, let's appreciate ourselves individually and collectively. Thank you so very much, our vote of thanks. Mr. Chairman, sir.
Thank you so very much, Piero. Thank you for that very extensive acknowledgement of all those who contributed to the success of today's event. May I take some announcements before we disperse? One, the next inaugural lecture, the 164th inaugural lecture of the University of Nigeria, will hold on Thursday the 29th of April at the Princess Alexandria Auditorium and Unity Hall at the Nsukka campus of the university. And that will be presented by Professor Greg Odo. Professor Odo is of the Department of Zoology and Environmental Biology. And he will be talking on limnological frontiers, an ichthyofaunal forecast of doom. Sounds, judging by the topic, it sounds interesting. Professor Odo is in the house. Can you stand up for recognition, actually? Professor Odo, thank you. Thank you so very much. And next, the 163rd inaugural lecturer, Professor Henrietta Okafor, has asked that I direct you as follows. The Vice Chancellor and the Principal Officers of the University, Deans and Provost here in the house, would receive a light refreshment at the office of the Deputy Vice Chancellor, University of Nigeria Enugu Campus, and the rest of us would be treated to a broader range of goodies at the main hall. So while the Vice Chancellor goes upstairs, we stay downstairs and wait for them to come down. And so may I thank you also very much for coming. And we're about to close. And then as is typical, we're going to close with a closing prayer. And that would be the second stanza of the national anthem, which has been acknowledged as a very powerful prayer. So can we get the national anthem, the second stanza, please? Thank you very much. Can we rise and pray? If you have the program, the lyrics is at the bottom of the program, just in case, because I know we all mastered the first stanza, and the second stanza has just refused to be mastered. Thank you so very much. Have you got it, DJ? just play the national anthem. It's the same. The grace, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. So thank you so very much. While we are standing, the Vice Chancellor's procession will leave in reverse order. Thank you so very much. Thank you.